This time on Whatever We Want, we talk about
the entire Obi-Wan Kenobi series, full series review, spoilers, major, huge big spoilers. There are time codes down in the description. If you would like to jump around to different points in the episode, we talk everything from Ewan McGregor and Hayden Christensen being back from the prequels, the character breakdowns, the possibility of season two, all that and more. We are also joined by Blake and Garrett from Blake's Takes. Thank you again for joining us. We'll see you in there. Enjoy. Welcome back to Whatever We Want, where we review content across all mediums of media, movies, TV shows, video games, and beyond to give you the most interesting behind-the-scenes insights, storytelling techniques, all that jazz, and more.
We go over everything from Marvel, Star Wars, Disney, Pixar, and more. Everything on screen has a purpose, and it's our job to figure out why. Without further ado, let's just jump right into it.
Here we are, main segment. We're joined by Blake and Garrett from Blake's Takes. Thank you guys just for being here. How are you doing today?
Absolutely doing great. Excited to be here. For anyone who doesn't know, this is our first guest podcast feature, so we are thankful for the first invite from y'all.
Yeah, I really appreciate you guys having us on.
Yeah, I'm super excited. We found you guys on TikTok. They make some great stuff. All their stuff's going to be linked below. I'll mention it again at the end, but make sure to check them out. If you guys enjoy this podcast, you seriously will enjoy their podcast. They, I don't know, just talk about great things. You guys do a lot of rankings, right, on TikTok?
We do, yeah. That's like... Well, I mean, we've always, you know, being brothers, we've always had that same mindset when it comes to film or TV shows. So we're always just, when we were kids, just talking back and forth, almost like a second language, just quoting things with each other. Yeah. And when I started this, it was just me at first. So it was like really hard to
to have a good back and forth with yourself.
Yeah.
So it definitely helped like when I started coming on and we could just like talk like we do in like every day.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. That's so nice. I don't know how like solo creators do it, honestly, like props to them. But Daniel, thank you for being here for me. we're gonna talk about the Obi-Wan Kenobi full series. It's finally out.
Yes.
Spoilers again, but yeah, I just kind of wanted to jump into things. Blake and Garrett, what are your just overall thoughts on the series as a whole?
Overall, I thought it was pretty good. Not as good as it could have been.
Okay.
Definitely had like a couple filler episodes, which I thought was kind of stupid because it's already a six episode series. I'm like, and speaking of that, I am not a fan of Disney's six episode format that they're doing for like all these shows.
He's already gone on a rant about
I've already talked about this on our channel, but it's just like, I mean, I feel like eight episodes at a minimum is like what you need, especially for like something like this. And obviously you can't have a filler episode in a six episode series. I don't know.
Would you say episode four was like a filler episode?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. That's the one where they were rescuing Leia from the facility, right? Yeah. That was definitely a filler episode. And like, obviously the highlights of this was just the moments that we got to see between Obi-Wan and Darth Vader. That
episode
was like,
this was a highlight for me.
I probably think it was better than what he thought. I mean, now I'm not going to sit here and act like I'm as a crazy Star Wars fan as he or like some other people are. So I know they probably have some more beef with it. But overall, I really liked Ewan McGregor. He did a great job. So did Hayden Christensen, as we got to see finally in, you know, the last two episodes. And one thing that stuck out to me too was they really showed us some creative ways of using the Force that we haven't seen in live actions yet.
Mm-hmm.
So I really enjoyed that. Fight choreography was really good.
What example are you thinking of specifically?
I mean, I'm mainly the last two episodes with, you know, Obi-Wan lifting up the rocks. We didn't really see that kind of level of force.
I mean, Rey.
Yeah, I was going to say Rey. She didn't chuck him at like Finn or anything.
She didn't attack people with him, but she lifted him.
I do know. We saw them use it a lot more in fight battles. I do know that.
I love like the fight between Reva and Vader. Like there was like this one shot where like he chucks her like to do like a cartwheel with the Force and the camera like follows her. That was sick.
No, that was, I did like that they were like using the Force in like a more practical sense when they were fighting.
Yeah.
Cause like he didn't even pull out his lightsaber. He was just like stopping her hand from doing
it.
So I did like to see that new way. You know what I actually thought about recently? So, you know, like how lightsaber throws have been like a big part of like Star Wars video games and stuff.
Yeah.
They don't really do that.
Yeah. No. That is very true.
Like, I never understood that. They do it all the time in the game, and then we never see it.
Yoda did it in Revenge of the Sith when they were at the Jedi Temple, but he just ran up and grabbed it out of that clone trooper.
Yeah.
He threw it, but he didn't force it back to him.
Right. Yeah.
I'm trying to think about how you do that as like a VFX artist. Like, would you have like a practical stick that you'd like chuck?
Right.
And like VFX has like a boomerang, it, you know?
And just the boomerang.
I feel like that might be the best way to do it. I don't know. Or maybe just make the whole thing CGI so you can like control like where it's going.
Yeah.
Yeah, true.
I don't know.
Seeing Vader as strong as he was with the Force, that was nice to see.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was going to say, like, the range of power that we're seeing in this, I felt like was beautiful. Seeing how Vader was, like, almost, like, at his peak, literally being able to, like, pull down that ship with, like, ease, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. No, like, come on. I think that was, like, a major focus that they wanted to do for this series was to show, like, how strong Vader actually is because, like, you know, the most we see him is in the original trilogy where CGI was not very good at the time. It wasn't even a thing. So I think they definitely wanted to show like what prime Darth Vader can do with the Force.
Yeah, that's something I want to talk about eventually with like how Obi-Wan kind of matches power level at the end. But before that, I want to talk about my just overall thoughts. Have you guys seen Lightyear that came out like last week?
No, we have not.
Okay, I won't spoil it, but this kind of reflects my thoughts on Lightyear, like where I feel like Toy Story has such like a high place in my film view, and because I have so much like nostalgia attached to it, because like one of the first like animated films I watched, and I feel like the prequels are kind of in the same boat that like nothing can really live up to that hype. So I think Obi-Wan Kenobi like can't and nothing can live up to that hype that I just have in my mind of the prequels because I loved them from like when I was a kid. But that being said, I did like the Kenobi overall, and just I think it stuck the landing honestly with the last episode. I was very worried in the middle, what you said, like filler episodes. Overall, I think it was pretty good. There were things that maybe could have been changed, but I honestly enjoyed it just overall. That's kind of my overall initial thoughts.
I like that because obviously, honestly, with anything you can kind of nitpick.
Right.
And, you know, choose things that like, oh, I don't like that they did that, whatever. But, you know, you just have to respect that, like, overall, it was a pretty good show.
Yeah. Another happy landing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Last episode was full of those callbacks.
Yeah. Yeah.
Point was made about nitpicking. I'm like, the way I see it, also just as an artist, like, you get to the point that you are, like, being, like, really nitpicky. That's kind of a good thing. That if you're not able to nitpick, that means there's still, like, a lot of big problems going on.
Yeah.
That then still need to be solved, you know? So if you're trying to focus on the little things, then yeah.
That's true.
So I feel like the series overall, it held up, at least in my case. I feel like it held up very well.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's one thing I want to talk about. I feel like in media, just in general, it's really easy to have a perception of something based on like the ending of it. Like I feel like Game of Thrones, people hate it because it ended so poorly and they just immediately write off the last like 7 seasons of development. And I feel like Obi-Wan Kenobi is kind of the opposite. Like I feel like the middle was kind of rough in some spots for some people, but because it ended so well, everyone's like praising it as like the best show ever. What are you guys' thoughts on just like, I don't know, that idea?
It is funny because we have talked about that Game of Thrones thing that you just talked about. You know, we have never seen a TV show like Game of Thrones have the entertainment industry just by the chokehold and you know, that last season happened and then no one just ever talked about it again. And this was a show that was being talked about, you know, throughout the whole year. You know, people having watch parties and everything.
You can go anywhere and not hear about it.
And then it was just poof.
Dropped off the face of the earth.
Yeah. Crazy.
So yeah, there's definitely some truth to what you said to that. I mean, that how you end something definitely leaves a lasting impression on what you think of the overall series. So it's unfortunate what happened to Game of Thrones, but
I do still think Mandalorian is the best series that Disney Plus has had so far.
I agree.
That's just 10 out of 10 right there.
I think it's interesting just the attention span now of consumers and like audiences. Like I like Moon Knight came out what, like 2 months ago? And I've not heard anyone talk about Moon Knight since like it came out. That's kind of unfortunate. It's cool that we live in this age that like we're getting so much content. But is it like too much almost? And like with TikTok, like that's kind of where we focus. Like attention span is so short. Like
something's, you know, something's hot for like a month and then the next thing you know, we're on to the next bit.
Nah, I know. And honestly, like as nice as it is that we are getting this much content because, you know, it gives us more to talk about as well for what we do.
Yeah.
But
true.
It is definitely saturated right now.
Yeah.
100%.
It's funny to think about, like, because back in the day, you just have, like back westerns. Back in the day. And then, like, okay, what's the next thing? Another western. You know, like, overall, like, the whole scope and scale of everything has changed. All these new crazy stories.
Yeah, it got very repetitive in the film industry.
Yeah.
It's just funny to think about that growth.
No, I was going to say, let's go through now and kind of talk about some of the individual characters and some moments from the series. So, I mean, the title character, Obi-Wan Kenobi. What do you guys...
I hated that guy.
What?
I'm just kidding.
Get out of the Zoom. What do you think of just his arc overall, kind of going from, like, sad B1 Kenobi to forgiving himself?
No, so I absolutely love that we saw a shook up Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Yeah.
It's Obi-Wan that was going through, like, PTSD, basically, from the events of Revenge of the Sith. And I know, you know, a decent amount of people, at least I feel like, had some beef with, you know, this Jedi having, like, these nightmares and PTSD. But I'm like, he's not a Jedi right now.
Right.
He's not.
And so, also, he's, like, a person at the end of the day. Yeah. I mean, I swear, it's like they think. Yeah. It's like some people think, like, Jedi are just these, you know, perfect beings that have no human emotions. I'm like, bro, no, he just lost, like, everything.
Yeah. His whole way of living was just destroyed, and he kind of blames himself for the, like, destruction of the old universe.
Well, that's one thing I love about this series, though, is how it, with the end, he was able to come to that realization that it's not his fault, because it was Anakin who was the one who ultimately made that decision. So that blame, he was able to be like, it's not me, you know?
Yep.
So I feel like that was a good way for that to transition.
Yeah, like, this was going to happen regardless of, you know, what... It did all lie with Anakin and his, like, insecurities and, like, you know, not being able to...
Fear of loss.
And... Yeah, he wasn't able to make a choice between the Jedi Order and Padme and tried to have both and did not work.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I liked his character arc for sure. He did get pretty strong there at the end pretty quickly.
That's actually something I wanted to talk about. I thought I liked the arc, and, like, if you think about, like, without looking at the show, just, like, on paper. But I feel like between episode four, he was still, like, very, like, depressed E1 Kenobi.
Yes.
And then, like, episode five happened, he was kind of still sad. And then that final fight, episode six, don't get me wrong, I'm so happy he was at full power level, or, like, the power level he was at, because it was an epic fight. But, like, it just kind of felt like he got there out of nowhere in my mind a little bit.
Yes, and I thought we were going to see him maybe get more in touch with the Force. Like, I know we got Qui-Gon at the end, but I thought maybe we were going to get that in between so that he could, like, reconnect more with the Force.
And that would be, like, sort of the bridge.
Yeah.
See, the rationale, like, that I kind of did with that was the reason he was so weak the whole time was, I think, because he was so afraid. Like, he was so terrified of Vader and everything. And not to mention, you know, he was just afraid of Vader, still suffering from the events of Revenge of the Sith. But then, like, when he had his, like, triumphant moment or whatever, when he, like, got all those boulders off of him, he, instead of thinking about Vader and, like, all his mistakes, he started thinking about Leia and, like, hope and, like, you know, like, these positive emotions versus, like, compared to being so down on himself. And I think that was, like, the big transition, was just, like, his mindset. Like, it was there, but he just wasn't using it the right way.
Yeah.
Okay.
I like that. No, I like that perspective of it.
See, this is why the Jedi Order is a bunch of bullshit, because everyone has attachments.
Yeah. Also, I just love in episode three, his line, like, only a Sith deals in absolutes. Like, that is an absolute in itself. Yeah.
And actually, I don't know the creator's name, but you guys know that purple puppet on TikTok?
Yes. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. He said that, like, he said something about, like, how it was... it was kind of intentionally done because the Jedi Order had become, like, so full of itself that, like, they thought they were above the Sith, but then, like, he just made an absolute talking about Sith only dealing absolutes.
Yeah.
I don't know, just, like, something about the hypocritical nature of the Jedi.
Right.
Yeah.
That'd be cool. Okay. Let's talk about Darth Vader. Thoughts on Hayden Christensen back. We talked about it a little bit. What do you guys think?
Obviously loved seeing him at full power. Like, we talked about that earlier.
Yeah.
That was amazing.
I love that we did get Hayden Christian back, obviously. And it's cool, too, because you can tell at points he was in the suit. I mean, people were making points of this as well. Just the way he would walk and his mannerisms as Anakin. Yeah. You can kind of see it back as Vader. You know, then obviously when we get to see half of his face, I mean, that was just great.
No, that was really cool. And I love that scene that in the finale, loved how they were, like, using the lighting of the lightsabers to like show like kind of like motion. When Anakin was talking and when Darth Vader was talking. I thought that was cool.
Yeah, yeah, I've watched like really so cool. many breakdowns of that scene. It's not even funny.
And then at the end with Palpatine talking to him, you know, you could see like maybe there that's another reason why Vader wasn't really holding his own like we thought he would in the end too in that last battle is, you know, Obi-Wan kind of, you know, can cloud his judgment. He focuses way too hard on him, maybe overthinking it and everything, and I don't know.
Definitely. I really just, from a cinematography standpoint, I just love Vader, like the silhouette that he creates. Like there were a couple shots in this series, like when he's like kind of bathed in the fire and then you see like his black silhouette was so cool. Yeah. When he's going through hyperspace and like kind of framed in the middle of the Star Destroyer. Like that was really cool.
Oh yeah.
No, he's just such an intimidating presence.
It's awesome. He's so tall.
Especially, I really like that one shot too. It was almost in a way like a jump scare when that first time they meet, Obi-Wan is running through the through those dunes and everything, and you just see like slightly on the left side this black feature, and then the red lightsaber just pop out.
Yes.
Like, oh wow.
Yeah.
And like Obi-Wan's kind of like framed in between the saber and him, so he's like trapped almost.
Yeah. Yeah.
That is cool.
I like the back to scenes though. Honestly, like when he was first realizing that Anakin was still alive.
Just being able to show the pain
that like Anakin was or Vader's still in after everything that's happened, and that kind of like emotional connection there. That I felt like that was a cool way not only to see how he's kind of like changed from episode 3, because technically if you think about it, this would be from Obi-Wan's perspective. He has no idea what Anakin's state is. He just knows that he's still somehow alive. So upon realizing that he's now Vader, that's like must be like, oh, shiitake, you know?
Yeah, yeah. I love that we see the full suit up of Vader. Never gotten that.
That was really cool.
So we're like, wow, he's really basically a robot.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, he's
more machine than
torso
man.
Left. And even that's like super damaged.
Yeah.
Yeah. What did you think about the flashbacks with Hayden Christensen?
I liked him.
Did you think he looked a little too old?
What? Yes. Yeah. They could they could have done some de-aging, but at the end of the day, I still liked it.
Well, here's what I don't get too is you see videos on YouTube of people doing, you know, better de-aging jobs.
Well, they didn't de-age him at all. They could they just like made a decision not to do it.
I don't know.
It's not like they couldn't have done it, they just didn't do it.
Maybe it's like not a memory, maybe it's like a vision, and it's like sort of like blending Obi-Wan like remembering the past but also thinking of what could have been if Anakin didn't turn, kind of.
I did see some people talking about that as well. It wasn't like so much a flashback as it was like hint, just like if things had gone differently.
Right. Okay.
But he had Padawan hair.
Yeah. Or maybe
Obi-Wan
like,
just remembers him. That's like his ideal Anakin. He's like, why did he get rid of that hair?
Maybe it was like mixing the two, like taking their present selves and putting them in a past situation.
Yeah. I know it's definitely what everyone wanted was some flashbacks, but I think they definitely just threw that in there.
Yeah. I kind of like what it was trying to show, like how Anakin's still learning from Obi-Wan. He has like lessons to teach him and I don't know.
I thought it was good how it was like showing how the weaknesses that he had when he was still a Padawan and a Jedi, like that's still happening now. Like he's still just as brash, just as overconfident. And it's normally these things that lead to Vader's defeat, because like otherwise he's unstoppable.
Right.
It's like mainly his mentality that like holds him back.
Yeah. Daniel, what do you think about the flashbacks?
I thought they were good. It's funny. I also watched the edit where they were all just literally put together. And it was funny looking at that, how well it actually just seems together. And it's almost like its own little story at the same time. I like that aspect of it.
Very cool. Yeah. All right. What did everyone think of young Leia? Because I personally thought the actress did a great job. That's such huge shoes to like step into.
Yeah, yes.
Very intimidating, but I personally really enjoyed her performance.
100% agree. I don't know why she even got any hate to begin with online. I thought she did an amazing job. And again, she's a child actress.
I know.
What do you want from her? She did amazing.
Yeah.
I loved Leia in this, and I loved that I wasn't expecting to get this, you know, Obi-Wan and Leia's story in this relationship. Yeah. And I loved it a lot.
If you think about it, like, Obi-Wan met Leia technically before Luke.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because it was so innate that like Obi-Wan was like watching over Luke, who suspect her.
I mean, he met Luke when he was
excluding
born.
The birth. But you know what I mean, right? Like, so like
yeah.
having them as like people actually interact with them, and it's kind of funny to think about like how they had this whole experience together. And again, going back to New Hope, or I don't know if there's gonna be any other instances to where Obi-Wan and Leia talk or anything.
Season
but
two,
right? Say it goes right into A New Hope. I mean, that kind of explains it to where she'd be like, "Hey, Obi-Wan, you're my only hope."
Yeah.
You know? So right. I love those kind of that dynamic there, and how they kind of like flipped it.
I saw someone say like, "Well, why didn't she just say in A New Hope like Obi-Wan, remember when we like you saved me as a kid?" But like I think they kind of saw that at the end because he says to her like, "Hey, they can never know that like we know each other." So I think she's kind of trying to hide that later. So you could say that. So I think that's. Yeah. Continuity there.
And not to mention, you know, these writers are trying to fill in stories and working off of movies from over 40 years ago.
And none of this was in the plan.
The most complex puzzle ever.
Yeah, exactly.
I saw someone, I think it's a little weird. The only thing with Leia is because Solo takes place, I think, a year before or after this. God. In like Star Wars, so like the age difference is a little weird when you think about it, but just maybe best not to think about it too much.
Oh, you mean with Han and Leia?
Yeah, because these two stories, Solo and Obi-Wan Kenobi, are like within a year of each other.
Yeah, it's just so hard to perfectly match all these storylines.
Yeah, I mean, they're doing a pretty decent job, but
yeah.
All right, so Reva, who has been getting a lot of hate, unfortunately.
Yeah, hot topic for sure.
Yeah, what are your guys' thoughts on the third sister?
I never had any problem with the third sister. I knew right away that that was the child in Order 66. I really didn't have any problems with Reva. Honestly, I was telling Garrett at one point that the Grand Inquisitor was kind of annoying me more than Reva at one point.
Yeah.
I mean, like, Reva wasn't my favorite. I thought her constant need to, like, be the, like, we just thought she wanted to be the best. Like, that was, like, what we thought her motivation was. And she was just so overzealous with it. I don't know. She just was trying way too hard, and it got kind of annoying. Like, just this constant, she just wanted to kill everybody. I'm like, bro, what are you doing? I don't know.
I think if you think about just Reva's character, it's a really interesting story. Like, it's, like, a youngling that has survived Order 66 and is now like infiltrated Vader's ranks, Inquisitor ranks, to try to like kill him. Like, I think that's really interesting. And she's almost losing herself to the dark side amidst all of it. I think it's really cool, but maybe it could have been like showcased better. Maybe. I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, it's definitely a really cool idea for sure.
I agree with you on that. I mean, she like kind of lost herself to the dark side, but not like 100%. Cause obviously she wasn't willing to go like full hypocrite. And it's like, hey, Vader killed me. Or Vader killed my friends when he was like back then he killed children. So now I'm going to get back at him by killing his kid.
Right.
He doesn't even know exists.
Yeah, true.
Well, at first I thought we were getting more of like the story of the second sister from Fallen Order.
Right.
And then they did his with that plot twist in episode 5. So I did like that plot twist, but yeah, I really liked the second sister Trilla story as well in Fallen Order.
Yeah,
I'm currently playing through that. I have actually not played it before.
Wow.
I've been on him to play it, and he's just like, oh,
I just bought it. I played the first level yesterday.
Good thing I didn't spoil anything.
Yeah.
Daniel, what do you think of Reva?
Again, I think a lot of the hate on her is just misplaced, because I feel like her character has a lot of good development, like from the point you said about her being technically a double agent. I think it's cool to see that she has her own drive and has her own purpose for like specifically what she's trying to do, you know. And it's sad to see that it didn't work, you know. Like, you feel for her at the end, or when she has that fight with Vader and she fails, you know,
she gets stabbed.
Like, I mean, what she think was gonna happen, honestly.
Yeah,
I mean, at the same time, we just saw him like literally like force choke a whole freaking thing or ship. So, like,
ship. Force choke a ship.
But you know what I mean. So she didn't stand a chance.
You did feel for her.
Yeah,
you feel for her, you know?
And that was a really cool fight.
Yeah,
that was a really cool fight.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, just imagine like having this absolute hatred towards somebody and wanting to, you know, get your vengeance on them that badly, but just not being able to pull it off because you don't have the power. Like, that's that's a very frustrating circumstance.
Yeah, so
especially
I guess
that's like your whole purpose of living.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
So that's probably what drove her to like just want to lash out and go after Luke.
Yeah.
I guess that makes sense.
That was something that she could do about it.
Yeah. I understand that story beat, but every time that it cut away from Vader and Obi-Wan to Reva, I was like, come on, yeah. Give me yeah. Vader and Obi-Wan.
Yeah.
But yeah, but when they were cutting back, what do you guys think of like the Owen Lars and Beru, right? Aunt Beru.
Oh, yeah.
So much. I like how she instantly went to like freaking war mode. She's like, all right, let's get the guns. Let's get set up.
Yep,
we're going to go take action. You know, I was like, okay.
Hey, man. Their job was to protect Luke, and they were like, hey, we're ready.
Yeah, I feel like there can't be any more Uncle Owen slander because he's kind of a badass.
Yeah. And he's honestly. Sassy, like with the remark to Obi-Wan, like he protected his father.
I thought his, like, I don't know, he was really, or his like anger towards Obi-Wan was kind of funny.
Yeah.
I really liked Uncle Owen in this.
Yeah. I thought it was interesting. The show creators, I feel like, really made it a point and were cautious so that like Luke never saw anything related to like the Jedi, the Sith, or like lightsabers. Yeah. Because in episode 4, like he seems like bewildered when he sees like a lightsaber for the first time. So like
bewildered, you know, points it right at his face.
I was paying attention to that too. I was like,
yeah,
because I know his initial reaction was like surprised when Obi-Wan was showing him a lightsaber for the first time. So I was like, he can't see Reva's. Like this can't happen.
Yeah, he's like out the top like hatch before she comes in the room, and then he's like unconscious when she approaches. So like they're very careful. So again, like tiptoeing on eggshells for continuity here, but
that was like another thing they did that a lot in like the Clone Wars about how he never met General Grievous.
Anakin,
they were like doing a trade and his Anakin head's was down passed he's out. Like
unconscious
so that they had to pay attention to that a lot.
Yeah, that one line of dialogue that they're reading that the first time line. It's like the same thing I saw somewhere that like because in episode 4, like Vader never finishes his thought. Like he's like, I haven't felt this presence since. And then like he walks off. That's why Obi-Wan can exist. Like this series is because he didn't like explicitly say like the Clone Wars or whatever.
A nice little cliffhanger there.
Yeah. What do you guys think of Tala? I personally kind of was like indifferent to her.
Well, yeah, I feel like we saw her a lot. And then all of a sudden it's like, I forgot about her.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Like her loss didn't feel like a huge loss.
Yeah.
She was just like kind of there and like played this role
I like that, you know, she was giving Leia her kind of rebel attitude, hope.
That's true. Aspect.
Yeah. Yeah. Introduced her to like that way of thinking, which was cool.
In the meantime, while she was there in the story, you know, I liked her, but then, I just completely forgot about her.
Yeah.
I mean, I think we were all just focused on what was going down with Obi-Wan and Darth Vader.
Yeah, that takes away from pretty much everything else.
I feel like if her sacrifice was in front of Leia, that would have had more of an impact.
Okay. For sure.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, because that would have, like, traumatized her.
And she was... That's the thing too, like with the rebels, we're so used to like the sacrificial play, you know, so
that's
it's
true,
kind of just like another rebel that's, you know, doing the thing for everyone else.
It sucks that you're kind of numb to that, but
that's kind of weird to think about.
All right, what about Qui-Gon guest appearance, Liam Neeson at the end there? Thoughts on that?
That was cool. I heard like there was some complaints going on about like how Obi-Wan's like abandoning his post of watching over Luke, but I mean, he did have to learn from Qui-Gon at some point, you know, how to become a Force ghost and everything. So he had to take some time to like do this training. So I'm looking forward to like, I mean, is there going to be a season 2? I don't even know.
Right now it's not confirmed, but Kathleen Kennedy said that they're going to listen to the fans. And if they want it, they might do it. If there's a story to be
like
told.
I feel like they probably will, but I feel like we're going to see a lot more. We would see a lot more of that and like his training with Qui-Gon. But I mean, I loved seeing Liam Neeson. That was cool.
Yeah,
honestly, maybe a little surprised that Disney did bring Liam Neeson back in like that.
Yeah,
with stuff that he's been in the past few years. I mean, it was what everyone was waiting for. Like I said, I did think we were going to see him earlier, possibly to see Obi-Wan reconnect to the Force more. It was cool seeing him back as Qui-Gon.
Yeah, I mean, they built it up for like the whole since like the first time we see Obi-Wan. So I felt like they didn't pay that off. I think people would have been upset. I think Daniel, you and I kind of predicted we said one of two things, kind of like what you're saying, but he's either gonna like reconnect with himself and like at the very end then Qui-Gon will appear because he'll be like open to seeing it, which is like what happened. Or we said kind of what you're saying, like maybe in his like most dire moment of need. I was thinking like when he's like under all the rocks.
Oh, the rocks.
Yeah.
When like then maybe Qui-Gon would have like spoken to him or something like that. And
that's
been, like,
when
hey.
I thought we were gonna get Qui-Gon in that moment, honestly.
Yeah.
Just get Qui-Gon saying, use the Force, Obi-Wan.
Oh my god, I was just about to say that.
He's like, Obi-Wan, why do you have the low ground right now? Vader, give it to you. I love that Vader just was like, earthquake, I'm giving you the low ground.
That was the other Force thing.
That was another unique Force thing that we saw. We've never seen that before.
Yeah,
that was cool.
That was pretty dope.
My kind of big question, those are kind of the characters I want to talk about, but did you think this story needed to be told for Star Wars? Because I love that like we're getting all these stories, but like, did we need it? It's a good, I think it's a question to be talked about.
It's a good question.
It is a good question. I mean, I like that it was told. I mean, it may not have been like 100% necessary, but I feel like it just like kind of answered the question. Like there was just a lot of ambiguity of what was going on between Revenge of the Sith and, you know, New Hope for Obi-Wan, and this
gap in between,
it's like a 20-year gap. Like, so this definitely helped answer some questions about like what was going through his mind, and it was satisfying to finally get those answers.
You know what? Based off that, I'm gonna say yes, it was needed, because this whole time, I think we've all wanted to see more story from Darth Vader and him as, you know, kind of this main character, not just coming in as the antagonist, always giving the same evil guy speech, blah blah blah. Come to the dark side, we can destroy the Emperor. Yes, I think it was needed in the aspect of giving us more of a story of Darth Vader and Obi-Wan. And yeah, there is a pretty big gap in between those events that I think a lot of people are curious of what happened in between them, between those characters.
Yeah, you agree with that.
I think this was needed, because I was kind of thinking about it. I think this story like really shows Obi-Wan like healing after the events of Revenge of the Sith, because in episode 3, like, he is like broken, like his whole world is like crumbling down, and seeing the effects that has on a person. And then like it just jumps to episode 4 and he's kind of like not happy, but he's kind of like pretty jovial Alec Guinness, like Obi-Wan, like kind of carefree. So like I feel like there was like a story to be told, like that transition out of that like depression from the old days into like accepting the new and forgiving himself. So I think that is what this needed to be and was. So I think that was important to tell. Dana, what'd you think?
Literally that.
Yeah,
it's hard to put it better than that. It's transitional, and that's why it was needed. Also, like you guys asked a question too, like needed versus wanted. I mean, we can always want to have more of the universe defined. I mean, we're getting all these other short stories and stuff coming soon as well, like with the Acolyte and the new Rebels stuff as well.
Does Disney want more money? Is the
like legit?
Yeah. So what it comes down to at the end of the day is what goes good for the story, what is needed for the story. And because this was, like we were saying, is transitional, I feel like it was actually needed and important for us to understand what was going on with Obi in this time.
Yeah,
Obi. Sure. So will a season 2 be needed?
I feel like a season 2 might not be needed.
Okay.
It'd be still fun to watch, but...
Obviously, you know, still entertaining and everything, but... If anything, I would like to get like more stories about like other characters during the same time period, though.
Okay.
Because like, you know, everything we see is like from the movies, and I would love a freaking Vader series. Like, that'd be awesome.
Okay.
Like just all about Vader. To me, that would be awesome.
Yeah.
I just want to see Vader.
Dude, he's just so awesome. Like, why can't we make him the main character for once?
I think... If they were to do a season 2, I don't know. I'm trying to think of, like, what elements would go in there. Like, maybe...
Right. Yeah.
I'm trying to think what happens between this and episode 4. So I was thinking maybe Qui-Gon and him could go, like, real estate, rent, like, property hunting for that, like, hut that we see him in episode 4. And it's just him going through, like, the Tatooine, like, property market. I don't know.
Yeah. Then it's also... And then, you know, big question, too, is like, oh, who's going to be the antagonist of this season to give us some conflict and all that?
Yeah.
The real estate market.
It's skyrocketing.
He just does Jedi mind tricks. You want to give me this house for half off?
Yeah, I don't really know what else there would be to tell about Obi-Wan, because, like, I mean, he's just on Tatooine this whole time.
Right.
This was like a rare occasion that he actually left that planet because he made a promise to watch over Luke. So,
well, did you guys ever watch Rebels?
I did. Yeah, he did.
You know, like with I don't want to spoil too much.
Well,
but
honestly,
he deserves to have it spoiled.
Not even that. I kind of know.
Do you know the big points like with Obi-Wan and Maul?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. In Rebels, like Maul and Obi-Wan fight, and I've seen Dave Filoni in like this breakdown. He talks about how Maul tried the same maneuver that he did with Qui-Gon. It would be cool to see Qui-Gon now teach Obi-Wan. Maybe they're like in their force training, they're like just in conversation analyzing like how Qui-Gon died. So maybe that like clues Obi-Wan into just how to counter that, and he starts thinking about that because of this conversation with Qui-Gon, and then that leads to Rebels, how he's able to like deflect it.
Yeah.
I feel like that'd be a weird conversation to have. Like, you're talking to your dead, practically dad.
I feel like any conversation with your,
and you're like,
dead master
let's
would be
break
weird.
Down how you died here, okay?
Yeah.
Where did you fuck up?
Yeah. What could you have done differently?
Man, do you ever think we'll get a live action Maul again?
That would be...
We saw him in, what was it? Was it Rogue One? We saw a live action Maul on like on the hologram?
No, you're thinking Han.
Or Han
Solo.
It was Han Solo.
Yeah. Oh, yeah? I forgot about that. Yeah. I only saw Solo once.
Yeah, and he like ignites his lightsaber for like no reason.
Yeah.
It would be cool to see what he's doing with Red Dawn and like that whole...
Crimson Dawn,
yeah.
Because he has a pretty cool story.
Dude, Darth Maul has become like one of my favorite characters between Clone Wars and Rebels. Like, I mean, that's another person. That'd be an awesome series to have him.
And Sam Witwer... like voices him and it's just down to do anything. I love Sam.
Force Unleashed
and everything.
Yeah, the voice actor for Maul is really good.
Cause there's a lot of conflict for Maul. Like he's like always had like aspirations of like what he wanted. He's always had like a set vision for the future. And honestly, if he could have just like let go of his hatred for Kenobi and just like forgot about him, I feel like he could have done so much more. He could have been a really successful Force user, like, you know, just like gained a lot of power in the galaxy if he would have just like forgotten about Kenobi, but he just could not let go of that obsession.
Right. But I'm just kind of thinking again with like people not letting go of Kenobi, like with Vader again. You'd like that segue there. I was trying to give back to Vader. But like, I think it's interesting again with, I'm going to kind of dissect the, when he like cuts his mask and we get the like again what you're saying with the light and Anakin versus Vader talking. I think it's interesting that Vader like he tells Obi-Wan that like it's not his fault. I don't know if that's like Anakin trying to like relieve Obi-Wan or if it's Vader trying to like confirm to himself like I did this to myself to give himself more hatred towards himself because that's what fuels him. I just think it was interesting that like he explicitly tells Obi-Wan like I'm not your failure. Like it almost felt like it could have been like a moment of like Anakin like trying to like ease Obi-Wan's like pain, but I don't know if he would do that. I don't know. I just thought that was really interesting.
I thought that line, I liked how that reflected later in New Hope when Obi-Wan was telling Luke that Darth Vader killed his father. So obviously a lot of similarities going on there so I like that they made that connection. But honestly, I think it was more about Vader personally.
Really?
Yeah.
I really think it was because like he was, I'm trying to figure out how to phrase this. But
it's tough to talk about. Yeah.
He just wanted to prove that like Anakin was dead.
Yeah.
Like, and you know, no matter, there's no point in trying to appeal to the Anakin side of Darth Vader. Like he just wanted to solidify, like, I am all that's left. I killed him. You had nothing to do with this. Okay. I killed Anakin. He's gone.
Gotcha. That's a good way to put it. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, that's tough. I mean, I guess the writers are gonna really only know the real reason.
Right.
Yeah, because Revenge of the Sith. Yeah, Obi-Wan really didn't do anything to kill Anakin. I mean, besides, you know, cut him in half,
attempting to murder him.
But here's the thing. But by then, Anakin was already inside himself dying. Like by then, by the time that happened, Anakin was already gone.
You know?
Like you weren't gonna change his mind.
See, I don't know if he fully committed to the Darth Vader persona, though, because I mean, yes, he was Darth Vader, but like, you know, obviously I think it was his love for Padme
that was
still keeping like that Anakin side around while he still had all his limbs and everything.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because, like, I mean,
prelim cut off.
Yeah. I mean, like, Padme was calling him Anakin and everything. He's not like saying, hey, don't call me that. Call me Darth Vader.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And obviously, Anakin was a very insecure person for sure.
What? What did you think that?
Dude, he was.
No, I know. I'm kidding.
Oh, okay. I was like, all right. I thought you were being serious. I was like, what are you talking about? My God. I mean, even we saw, there's an episode in Clone Wars where he was just like so jealous of that guy that was hanging around. Oh, my God.
I know. Yeah. What do you guys think?
I feel like at that point, it's more Vader. I don't think Anakin's like here at this point. If anything, he might come out in like little fractional action, like for example earlier when Obi-Wan was being like totally like scraped in the fire in like episode, was that two
three?
Or three?
Three, okay. Yeah,
yeah. So the whole like, and then like reignite the fire, then he's just like, okay, I'm just gonna let Obi-Wan go. Like, what caused him to like let him go? Because he could have totally just picked him up again and just skimmed him across the floor. So in moments like that, I feel like Anakin kind of like came and was like, what's going on here? What's causing me to have this anger in this way? Like, I know he's my master, but at the same time, he's against me. But do I want to be doing this? And like moments like that, to where it's like that internal conflict is hitting him.
See, I feel like there was a different reason for that moment. I mean, obviously, he can't kill him yet because of continuity. But I feel like in that moment,
yeah,
I feel like in that moment, Vader wanted to have a hunt. He wanted.
Yeah,
he wanted Obi-Wan stronger. Like, he wanted this to be a battle. You know, he didn't
want to kill like a wounded kitten.
Yeah,
he wanted to kill like the lion that was Obi-Wan. Yes,
exactly. So he wanted this to be prolonged. So I think he just let him go to like, all right, well, we'll see. Yeah. We'll see how he is next time.
And he definitely just wanted this suffering to like last longer.
Yeah,
that's true. Yeah,
I think. But back to the episode six thing. I think it might have been mostly Vader trying to like convince himself. But I think part of it was like, again, what we're seeing with the light, that there was a little bit of Anakin within him maybe influencing it slightly. Maybe it's a mix of both. I don't know.
Well, because there's the thing too is Luke always felt a little bit of Anakin in him as well.
Yeah.
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 So it's like always kind of there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Great seeing his face. And then obviously, you know, see it again in Rebels. I do know that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Heavy.
Yeah.
They're heavy inspiration from Rebels with that Ahsoka
versus Ahsoka. Vader, yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
I need to watch Rebels again now. We just watched it before this series.
So good.
Yeah.
Well, and then people were saying, you know how in episode six, we see Vader's whole, you know, face for the first time and he has like that mark up here.
Yeah.
Which is on the opposite side of where Ahsoka cut his mask. So people were like, oh, when Obi-Wan, that's the mark from Obi-Wan. And what is that?
Oh, I've seen some people think that. I've seen some people point out that maybe it was he had that already in episode three. I don't know. I'd have to go back and watch, but that would be really cool if that is how he got that.
Yeah. Mark from Obi-Wan.
Yeah. So he's never truly gone.
Yeah.
Released from Obi-Wan. Yeah. I saw just a little behind the scenes thing. I saw in episode two, the girl that comes up to Obi-Wan in like the like meth lab planet, wherever the heck, when Leia's running away.
Yeah.
Spice.
Breaking that episode.
Yeah. She said like, I was once someone's daughter. That's actually Ewan McGregor's like real life daughter.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Cool. I did see that on, I think, Twitter. I saw that. Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah. I also saw someone
say... That's a missed opportunity, man. Should be like, you want to buy some death sticks?
Oh, my gosh. But Ewan McGregor in real life is like 51 when they were filming this. And he's like 10 years younger than Alec Guinness was when Star Wars in 1977 was released. So, and because this place takes place like 10 years apart, like it's around like exactly the right age that Alec Guinness would have been 10 years before A New Hope, which, I mean, Ewan McGregor looks really good for 51.
Yeah, I know. Alec Guinness definitely looked a little more seasoned than Ewan McGregor.
I was going to say, I think that just goes back to people's lifestyle back in like the 60s and 70s anyways. It just age caught up with them a lot easier than these Hollywood stars now.
Yeah.
And not to mention, I think people just need to, if like, you know, they keep talking about using like deep fake type stuff to like make him look a little bit more like Alec Guinness. But I'm like,
That's a bit extreme.
Yeah, I'm like, come on. It's different.
Just for a whole series.
We know it's different people. Like, who are we fooling? We don't need to fool ourselves. It's fine.
Yeah, and then people would just complain and nitpick, like, the VFX and not pay attention to the story. Like, I feel like this was the best choice to just let Ewan McGregor be Obi-Wan.
Yes. Also, yeah, it's Ewan McGregor. He has the most beautiful hair. Let him be him.
Yeah, exactly.
How did his hair not get burned in that fire? Who knows, but who cares?
Who cares?
The force, okay? We'll just...
Yeah, the force.
He has, like, a force field. Like an actual force field.
For his hair. He was using the force to protect his hair, okay?
That's that, it. That was his shoulder was, concern. Like, beat up, but he was like, my hair needs to remain. Yes.
Obi-Wan's hair is just as much a part of his character.
Yeah, the mullet. Yeah, so where does this... There are a lot of things that happen between episodes 3 and 4. Like, there's Rogue One, the Bad Batch technically kind of crosses into there.
Yeah, it does.
Rebels, Jedi Fallen Order, Solo, and Kenobi. That's like six things. There's a lot that's crammed in between episodes 3 and 4, but...
I didn't even think about that.
I kind of wanted to ask everyone's thoughts, like, where does this rank in terms of, like, all the things between episodes 3 and 4? Because there's a lot now.
That's tough. That's tough because it's across media too, because of the games.
Yeah, some are animation, some are games. That's hard.
So, like,
I guess, like, for the games, I'm like trying to just I'm just trying to compare the story.
Yeah, I'd say Solo's at the bottom. That start that off easy for me.
Yeah, that's I can agree on that one.
All right,
you got
next?
Pen and paper. Let me write them all down just so I can. It helps. All right, I just want to see them all.
Try to put you on the spot like this.
I like this question.
It's what we do. We rank.
Yeah.
I just gotta think about it. Okay, so we're definitely putting Solo at 6.
It's hard to compare like Rebels in this too, because like we get a lot of content in Rebels.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
Thrawn's arc. Oh man.
Yeah, bro, I loved seeing
that.
Thrawn was great.
I kind of feel like next would have to be like Bad Batch, sadly.
I got Bad Batch at 5.
Oh, wow.
Which is because it's so great. Don't get me wrong, but I feel like the other content's just there's either more of it or it's better.
Yeah, it's just better. I mean,
yeah.
Next, I would either put, I feel like I would put Obi-Wan at 4 or 3. Whoa. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I think that's about where I would put it too.
Yeah, same.
I want to put like Rogue One at 4, honestly, because I love I don't know. I love it. Don't get me wrong. I loved Rogue One, but I loved the story in Jedi Fallen Order. Like, that's got to be higher for me.
Okay.
And I think number one out of all these, though, is definitely going to be Rebels.
Wow.
I'm going to put Rebels.
I would not hear a lot of people that would say that. Okay.
I loved Rebels. I don't know what people.
That's why I got Garrett around. He's got hot takes.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I would say Obi-Wan definitely like 4 or 3 out of this group of content.
Dang. I don't know what I would do. I think I would put Solo at the bottom, of course.
Yes.
Just because I haven't played Jedi Fallen Order, I have to put it next after that, just because I personally haven't played it, unfortunately. Then I think I have Kenobi and Rebels kind of at the like 3rd and 4th position.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, because the beginning of Rebels, like, I didn't really enjoy the first season too much. Like, I really enjoyed like season 2, 3, and 4.
I can agree with that. And also, I feel like those shows like Clone Wars and Rebels, though, they grow with their audience a lot. Like,
yes.
Like the ending seasons are always, they're more mature. It's more serious. And, you know, the stakes are just like higher.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then I think my number 2 will be Bad Batch. I just really liked Bad Batch.
Really?
I really liked it. And the animation, just like visuals on it are really good. And then Rogue One is honestly number 1 for me. I really like that story. And this and Vader at the end, like,
okay,
come on.
Vader
it's hard to beat
like,
that hallway scene.
He didn't like save the movie with that scene, but you know, like he just upped it a lot.
Anyone else want to take a crack at it?
Again, Solo at 6. just to clarify. Then I want to say 5. I'm gonna say Bad Batch again, because it's still great, but I feel like there's better stories in the rest of the stuff. Number 4. I think I'm going to say Obi-Wan there.
Okay.
And the reason for that is because my number 3 would be Fallen Order, because it's different. It's its own story, it's in its own bubble, and it gives a completely new story away from like all the original characters, you know?
Uh-huh.
And it did really well in that instance of being able to tell its own story of another Jedi with like, I'm trying not to spoil anything for Jake.
I know,
but like,
yeah.
Sorry, I'm sorry. You can spoil up to level one. We played level one.
Okay, so what does that leave me? So number two,
I think you have Rebels still.
Yeah, it's going to be Rebels for number two, and then number one's going to be Rogue One.
Okay.
And, again, the reason I think that is because Rebels opens up so much for other characters within
like
that time span.
Time travel and stuff.
Yes.
Yeah, like that's crazy.
No, I was just saying I agree. That was so cool that we got to see what we saw with like Ezra and like, you know, seeing like different portals at different times. That was really cool. But continue. Yeah.
And then my number one is Rogue One because it sets up A New Hope so perfectly. And again, just being able to see, again, like it's just the classic play of like the Rebels sacrificing or doing the sacrificial play, but in this instance, it was nice
that
to see.
The entire story was just
that. Was the entire story, but yeah. Like it was really the pivotal moment of when the Rebels were able to unite and really start off being the rebellion.
K2SO, I love K2SO.
Hmm. Okay, yeah, six, Solo, five. Like I said, I haven't seen too much of Bad Batch, so I'll just have to put that at five. Okay. Yeah, the middle part's where it gets tricky.
Yeah.
Because honestly, right? I think Obi-Wan and Fallen Order are pretty interchangeable to me. Because I really did like Fallen Order, but sometimes Cal Kestis would annoy me. I don't know. maybe not Cal as much as
his like master. What,
no, no, not the master.
I know who you're talking about.
Who he was traveling with.
Yes.
What's her name?
Yeah.
I met her yesterday. I don't remember her name.
I know it.
I forget. I know who you're talking about though.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think it was her that annoyed me.
She was kind of annoying. Yeah, she thought she was going to solo Vader.
So honestly, I might do, okay, this is just going to be me. I'm going to do Fallen Order at four, Obi-Wan at three, Rogue at two. I mean, Rebels, I mean, just so much happens to Rebels. And
Rebels is one, but you haven't seen all of Rebels.
Bro,
he always watches the highlights of stuff.
I have to.
Like he just like doesn't bother with the filler episodes.
Especially when you
kind
you
of
got,
annoys me.
You got moments with Ahsoka and Vader. I mean, it's just, and you know, there's four seasons, yeah. So it's kind
of
hard not
so
to.
So the highlights of Rebels is your number one.
Yeah, he literally okay. Just like he pisses me off the way he does it, but whatever.
That's funny. Okay, cool.
Oh, I got a question.
Okay.
How do we feel about the music in the series? Were we upset that there was not really many prequel themes in it?
I was thinking about that because I remember John Williams came back for this and I was super excited about that, but nothing really like wowed me so much that like I remember like usually in like the prequels and stuff, the first time I hear it, like if it was like a really like, I don't know, like Battle of the Heroes or like a prominent score, like I would, like it would jump out at me.
Yes.
This time I felt like on my second viewing, I would like be intentionally like listening for scores. Yes. And that was the only way I could like pay attention to them, which is not always a bad thing, but yeah, I don't think anything was as like epic as like Duel of the Fates or any of other, any of John Williams' like previous work. Really.
Yeah, agreed.
Which, I feel like it's okay. Cause this wasn't really anything as pivotal as the moments that we saw in the movies.
It was pretty pivotal, you know? For Obi-Wan. Like,
I mean, it was pivotal for him personally, but it wasn't like Fate of the Galaxy pivotal. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like hence like Anakin and Obi-Wan fighting, say Revenge of the Sith, you know?
Yeah.
So, like that had to be epic. In this case, this is more something where it's like Obi-Wan's coming to that realization. So I feel like, I don't want to say it's excused in that sense, but like,
okay.
It kind of makes sense.
I get what you're
like,
saying.
Because
imagine
though. If it was more epic than that. That would
yeah,
be kind of...
That wouldn't really like make sense. I get what you're saying. The stakes were a lot lower.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But so, I mean, Garrett knows like music is like a big thing for me. I'm always, you know, my ears are always glued to that music. But here's the thing. In the prequels, I mean, yeah, Revenge of Sith, as you were saying, a pivotal movie for the Star Wars storyline. But like every theme in there was just slapped so hard. It was so good. Like even, you know, moments with Padme and like the...
We were listening to, what was it? So we're doing a thing kind of inspired by your series. We're going through every episode and ranking the top five scores from each one. And in episode three, there's one that's just called Grievous Speaks to Sidious.
Yes.
And it could just be a conversation, but it's like the most intense music ever. It was like
I was literally listening to that while working out at the gym the other day.
Yeah.
Like,
that's awesome.
Like episode three, that whole score... There are just no skips in that score.
Yeah.
There's just no skips. And my thing was like, okay, I get it. Obi-Wan is trying to do its own thing with the music. You know, they give us the Imperial March at the end. That was really cool. But then it's also like, why are you going to tease us with the trailer in Duel of Fates? You're going to
open up
this trailer.
Yeah, true.
Just send chills down our spines with Duel of the Fates and Obi-Wan. We're like, oh my God. But then we get none of it during the series.
Yeah, no, I can definitely see that. I don't know. I wonder if there'll be any like re-edits. Like, I know a lot of people like change the music. Like, maybe they'll do like, someone will like do a master edit of like cutting the final Vader Obi-Wan fight, but like put Duel of the Fates or something over it.
I've already seen plenty of people doing that on TikTok. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to lie. It like gives me more chills when I hear that music over this fight.
But again, is that nostalgia? Like, because we grew up with that, will like the next generation grow really attached to these songs or something? Maybe
it's either that or just like, I mean, critically, I feel like it's just better music.
Yeah.
No, I mean,
so
I agree.
I mean, like, if you were to show this to somebody who like didn't watch Star Wars, but you show them this fight with this music and the fight with this music, like, I feel like they would still choose, you know, Duel of the Fates and everything from the prequels.
Yeah, because I mean, what you said, you know, Revenge of the Sith, that score, I mean, that's probably one of my top five scores of all time, probably.
So wow. Good. Yeah.
Yeah.
So
that was a good question.
I have like a top 10 scores of all time list coming soon.
Yeah. I'm appreciating the questions, man. You got some good questions.
Yeah. I mean, I think Blake asked that question, so thank you. But yeah.
I mean, yeah.
Music, I'll take the credit for it.
I absolutely love, like, when I'm watching a movie or TV show, you know, music, that if it's great, it'll stick out to me right away. And that's honestly how I remember a lot of scenes. Like,
yes,
I'll just go back and listen to the music, and I'm just visually in my brain, I'm just, you know, I remember that whole scene.
Yeah.
I call it smelling the music.
Yeah.
That's what you're doing.
That's what Daniel says, because you often like smells bring you back to things.
Yeah, Grievous talking to Sidious, that.
That's it's so intense for like no reason.
I know.
I can't like picture that in my head right now, but I'm gonna listen to that after now. I wanna hear this.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, there's no skips on that score.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I mean, that's kind of all I wanted to talk about with, I mean, I could talk about Kenobi for like hours, but any final wrap up thoughts you want to talk about?
I hate to end on like a sour note, but did we want to talk about like some of Disney's like flops with like the chase scene with Leia and stuff
gosh.
Like that?
Oh yeah. Like, why were they fumbling so much? Like, it's like,
I do not know. And like, apparently a tree branch is enough to
just
stop you.
Yeah. It's just
your tracks.
Oh, no, I can't do
but
anything.
Then, again,
it's like Skyrim logic.
That's like, it was so early that like, maybe I kind of forgot about it a little bit. It's been like 4 weeks, 5 weeks since then.
Yeah.
I don't know.
But there was just like, there's just like stuff like that. And I feel like it's not specific to Kenobi either. Like, I feel like we see that a lot just in like Disney shows in general. Like, they cannot get their chase scenes down. I don't know. There was the chase scene in Boba Fett that was just god awful.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. That's very true. We should do rank next time. Next time we have you guys on, we'll do rank top five worst Star Wars chase scenes.
Yes. We gotta get another ranking in.
Yeah.
Damn, I know. I even forgot about Boba Fett already. Jesus.
I know. The attention span. Seriously, what else has come out? Like,
to be fair, Boba Fett was a little bit more of a forgettable series.
Yeah.
I liked it, but I mean,
until Mando came.
Yeah,
Mandalorian 2.5.
Exactly. Freaking Mando was star of the show, and he was only there.
Well,
like,
I was really enjoying when we were getting the Tusken Raider story from him.
Yes.
Yeah.
I did like that a lot. Yeah. But then they just dumped that after a few episodes.
Yeah. He was like, he's sealed.
I think what they should have done, instead of doing his flashbacks, I feel like they should have just done it in order. Because one of the biggest problems with that show was understanding his motive for what he was trying to do.
Yes.
And it wasn't until like after he saw what happened with like him and the Tuskens and him, you know, trying to do right by them. Like,
yes.
We should have just started like as soon as he crawled out of the Sarlacc pit.
Yeah.
That would have flowed better for sure.
Oh, well.
I think even, I always forget this act, the dude who plays him. What's his name?
Tamara Morrison?
Yes. There's this one.
The cameo also in this? Sorry to interrupt.
Oh, yeah. you're good. Trooper.
Oh, yes.
That was cool. They were filming those at the same time. I looked up, he said in an interview that they were like filming Boba Fett and like Boba Fett reshoots, I think, and like Obi-Wan at the same time. So he just like walked to the next stage and like they filmed that.
I just put a beard on you.
Yeah.
That was a good cameo. I like seeing that.
I really like that.
Yeah.
But yeah, there was this one report where he was in this interview and he said if they were to do more Boba Fett content, which obviously he's always down to do more Star Wars stuff, that he kind of wants to get Boba Fett just back to, you know, the badass character that he was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I mean, yeah, we could probably just talk another hour about Boba Fett and Cad Bane and all that, but
actually I had one when I saw that cameo though, it made me think of something. Okay, so we know from Clone Wars that the reason Order 66 like just triggers them like that is because they have the chip in their head.
Right.
What would happen if that old clone realized that Obi-Wan was a Jedi? Would Order 66 click in his brain again?
I wonder. Maybe. Maybe.
I'm curious. I'm really curious.
Yeah. Like, yeah, maybe like as he's walking by, like if he sees like a flash of his lightsaber like peek out from his cloak, like maybe he would have. Yeah.
Or like if he realized he was a Jedi, like would Order 66 restart in his head?
Right.
I have no idea.
Maybe.
I wonder if that's like a time thing though, because I think in, I don't know if the comics, this comic was canon. It was like a Vader comic to where like he was hunting down a Jedi. He was being surrounded by, at this time, there's still a bunch of other troopers with him. And he's like, that's Anakin Skywalker, because he knew who Vader was. The Jedi knew who Vader was. So he's like, the Jedi was like, execute Order 66, and the clones turned on him. And then,
it was
weird. Really? I don't know if that's canon or not, but like, I wonder if it's like a time thing to where if like the clones are like, okay, like, or if it's like a realization like, oh, that logic doesn't make sense. So that's a good thing to think about. Like,
yeah,
what would re-trigger it, you know?
Yeah.
Almost like, you know, Winter Soldier moments, or you know, those type of stories where, you know, they're just triggered by certain things.
Yeah, like homecoming, freight car, or whatever the trigger words are.
Yeah. So that would make interesting. Dang. Yeah, that would be interesting.
Oh, actually, question for you guys.
Yes.
What did you guys think of the new droid designs? Like Lola, we got that like new freighter carrying guy. I thought the freighter one kind of looked like Master Chief a little bit. I'm like, do you think they did that after the like show for what they did? Like, I don't know. What do you guys think of the new designs?
I like the designs.
And I thought Lola was like, it was just, she was just like a cute little droid to have for a little girl. I don't know. I liked Lola's design too. She looked like a ladybug.
Yeah. Yeah. I like how they always can innovate with the droid designs. Like they always do something new.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I mean, yeah. Endless possibilities with that.
Cool. All right. Well, thank you guys seriously for joining us for this. It's always
thanks
a blast talking
yeah,
about
absolutely.
Star Wars.
Thanks for having us. Definitely invite us back anytime. We
yeah,
have
that'd be yeah, great. Yeah. I'd love to chat more about Star Wars, Marvel, any fandom stuff, really.
So much to talk about.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Boosh, out of the main segment. Thank you so much again, seriously, to Blake and Garrett for joining us. That was actually a lot of fun.
Really cool, guys.
That was a little bit of a longer episode from what we normally do, but some good stuff in there.
Yeah.
Yeah, everyone, please, seriously, I mean it, please check them out. They're linked below. Yeah, they make some really awesome content. And seriously, I think we are like audiences aligned very well. So if you do enjoy our podcast, first of all, thank you. But also
go check them out.
If you want are looking for more content, yeah, please check them out. All right, ready to jump into the next segment. We're gonna kind of rapid fire through the next one. It's totally Tubular Trivia Tidbits.
Yes. Yes, 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 yes.
Did you know that Glenn Powell, the guy that played Hangman in Top Gun, almost played Rooster?
Oh, I didn't know that.
So both Miles Teller and Glenn Powell were auditioning for the role of Rooster and got to the final selection, and the filmmakers ultimately decided to give the role to Miles Teller. Glenn Powell was actually like devastated, and when he was offered the role of Hangman, he almost turned it down because he felt like the role wasn't as good compared to Rooster, and he kind of had his heart set on that. Powell then had like an eye-opening moment with Tom Cruise. Tom Cruise told him that you don't pick great roles, you pick great movies and then make great roles out of them. And then so he accepted the role and gave a great performance, in my opinion. And I think it was great casting all around for that film.
Yeah, it was great. I haven't seen all of Top Gun. My
Yeah.
Mine got cut out right when they're like, eject, eject, eject. And then the whole theater cut out. So,
yeah, like in the middle of the movie, Daniel's screening broke the movie theater. All right, anyways, you ready for jump in the next segment? Top five, Rank
yes.
Valley. All right,
yes,
again,
yes, yes, yes.
Here we go. This is the segment of the show where we're going to go through our top five Star Wars themes from Empire Strikes Back. I think it's me. I'll go through my top five Star Wars themes from Empire Strikes Back. My number five, I actually have... This is tough. I kept going back and forth. I have the city in the clouds. This is just a good theme. Like, it's cool, just the city itself, like Cloud City, and the concept of Cloud City is really cool. And just, like, beautiful, like, the color they use. the guy running through with the ice cream machine. Very cool.
Yes.
Number four, I have The Duel.
Okay, nice.
And that's this is like kind of like an amalgamation of like a bunch of different themes. Like, but like it has in it has like part of like a more epic version of the City in the Clouds theme. But like also just like what's happening here, like it's leading towards the greatest reveal in cinema history with like Vader being Luke's father. Spoiler, sorry. And like Lando and Leia like escaping. Like again, just a very cool theme.
Mm-hmm.
All right, those are the toughest ones. It got pretty easy after that. So number three, I have Yoda and the Force.
Oh, okay, okay.
It's very calming. It's a nice change of pace in the middle of like the Empire striking back. But this is the moment where Yoda's lifting the X-Wing out of the swamp. And it is just amazing. The score, like in this moment, just brings me back to that moment. I was thinking also, should we do like a top five moments for all, like Star Wars? Like
for each one or just in like...
Maybe every trilogy, like top five moments. Okay,
we could do that. That'd be cool.
So maybe after every time we finish a trilogy. So after we finish episode six, next time we can go back and do...
like top five moments.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyways, number two, this might be a hot take, but Imperial March is my number two.
Ooh, interesting.
I feel like in this series I say iconic too much. This is more than iconic. It's like legendary. It matches and elevates someone who is arguably the most feared character in cinematic history.
Yeah,
it's so close to number one, but it's not my number one. My number one is the asteroid field.
Really?
Might be a hot take.
Why?
Because it's just this amazing moment when they're like flying through the asteroids and like the Millennium Falcon is being pursued and just them in flight is just so amazing. And like the instruments like kind of battling off of each other again. I just really like that moment.
Hmm.
So that's my list. Might be a hot take.
That is a hot take. That's not what I would have picked.
All right, what about you?
I get your thing. So
let me hear your top five Star Wars themes from Empire Strikes Back.
I have The Duel. For a lot of same reasons you did, but I don't have City in the Clouds in mind, but The Duel, like you said, had those high beats that were pretty much that, but also more.
Yeah.
So that's why I have The Duel there. Also, it's kind of important for like the most pivotal point of like
Star Wars.
Star Wars.
All right, my number four.
My number four is Yoda's theme, because it just makes me...
Yes.
It just takes me straight back to Dagobah.
It feels like Dagobah and like home almost. Even it's weird because you've never been to Dagobah, but it feels like home somehow. So, and the score carries that.
Which is funny to also think about because Dagobah's a dark force well planet. Yeah. Like it's the whole reason of Yoda going there is to hide his light side. So it's kind of funny that Yoda's able to still make himself at home no matter where he's at. So I felt like that was
a good quality to have just in life.
Yeah. So my number three is actually hyperspace.
Oh, I mean, that's close, similar to the asteroid field. But yeah, that was
on
my contender for in my top five.
It's just so more, to me, at the very least, it just feels much more action-y. And just the way that the music swells and lulls, it feels like it's just more attentive. I don't know how else to describe it. It feels more attentive, and I like those moments in that score.
Gotcha.
My number two is Lando's Palace.
Oh, okay, where... What,
yeah, Lando's Palace, because it made me... Again, it makes me think of not only Lando, but it also makes me think highly of Bespin, and just takes me to... There's a warmth to it. There's a warmth to the score, and it's inviting, and I like that.
Okay.
Which then brings me back to number one.
It's number two. Wow, that's pretty high.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, I like that a lot. I like that vibe a lot. And then that brings me to number one, which is the Imperial March, because that is the exact opposite of that. Instead of it being warm,
makes me not feel warm.
Where I'm now being hunted or I'm now being invaded upon. And I feel like
invaded upon
is very important there.
Yeah. So, all right. That's a good list.
That's my five. Yeah.
All right. That's, I think, all we're going to talk about this episode. Thank you for being with us for this full episode. Again, please check out Blake and Garrett from Blake's Takes. Thank you guys for coming on. Appreciate it. We'll have to have them back on again. That was fun. Yeah, if you've enjoyed this episode, please share it with a friend. That helps us out a lot. Leave a review on Apple Podcasts or on a comment on our YouTube. Really appreciate that. You ready for patron shout-outs?
Yeah, hit me with them.
Cue the epic Star Wars music. Boosh, got patron Lori, Frank, Rick, Lisa, Evan, Tony. Thank you so much for watching this here. Thank you for this shout out. If you'd like to support us over on Patreon, the link is down in the description. You get the audio episode early. Special benefits, cool perks, all that jazz, and more. Also, I know Tyler, our friend Tyler, also just pledged to us on Patreon. Thank you. Appreciate it. He's not in the tier that like gets a shout out every week, but I just wanted to say thank you. Yeah, I don't think we have any new comments, which is totally fine. totally tubular. We have some comments from our Miss Marvel one. People are just congratulating us and for working on that. So thank you.
Awesome.
Please feel free to leave a review on Apple Podcasts. That helps us out a lot.
Quick note. Since we were talking about Miss Marvel, I talked to you about it earlier. Apparently, I'm also in that. When episodes end, and yes. There's like that end title screen that like suggests, oh, maybe you want to watch Miss Marvel. I'm on that end title. I'm like cut in half on the left side. So keep an eye out for that. That's me.
Cool. All right. Ready for the introduction?
Yes. Tell me when.
When?
We just talked about whatever you want to talk about, and now we're done.
Thank you so much for listening. Seriously, really appreciate everyone that has been listening and has found us. I hope you are enjoying this. We are actually trying something new next week. We talked a little bit about season 2 predictions for Kenobi. We've had this idea we've talked about before called like pitch practice, where we kind of go through and we want to spend a whole episode just pitching like a concept for a show. So we want to, next week, we're going to try to go and pitch and just like talk through creatively what a Kenobi season 2 would look like. We're going to try to bring on a special guest, not sure who that's going to be, but someone affiliated with Star Wars or like film or something like that. So we just kind of want to like go through the creative process of like, if we were given the reins to Kenobi season 2, what would we do? So I'm excited for that. Subscribe so you don't miss that next week, and see you then. Goodbye.
Bye.